Church, as we continue in worship this morning, we worship the Jesus who rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, announcing a different kind of kingdom that the world had ever known. A kingdom where the blind see, the lame walk, those who are broken are restored, and where we can be with our King, the one who gives his life for us. And so as we continue in worship this morning, we invite all ages, wave your palm branches. We're going to march because 2,000 years ago, everyone came running to see Jesus the King. And so we're going to do that. We're going to march around this center section, out into the foyer, back into the sanctuary. We're going to praise our Jesus together. Worship with us.
Washing over all our sins. prayer with me.
Excited to be here. I love combined worships. I love being with my entire church family and visitors all in one place. And I get excited. And then when you pair that with what I think is one of the most exciting stories ever written, is all of this week, this recognizing and celebrating him, and then to the sadness of crucifying him and losing him. But we did not lose him. He came back in 3 days. And that's an exciting story. And I'm excited to celebrate that with you guys, starting with this week and all of this Holy Week. So if you would just take a minute and just welcome all of those, our church family and our visitors, and tell them, I am so glad to be celebrating with you this morning.
Celebrate this beginning of Holy Week on Palm Sunday. How exciting it is to think about all that we get a chance to focus on this week. In your bulletins, please take note of the special services. On Wednesday night, we will be having our Jerusalem experience, and that's a chance to go back in time and to experience how it was on the time that Jesus lived and was in Jerusalem for Passover. That's Wednesday night. We invite you to come at 7 o'clock. On Thursday evening, we will celebrate our Maundy Thursday service, and we will end that night with communion. So we have a great focus of how the Lord shared that Seder meal with his disciples on the evening that he was betrayed. On Good Friday, we celebrate again at 7 o'clock. All services are at 7, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. We celebrate Good Friday. Kind of a paradox, isn't it, that Good Friday... It is a Good Friday because indeed it was the beginning of redemption. Amen. For mankind. So we're going to celebrate Jesus on the cross and then come together on Sunday morning. We have two worship services on Easter Sunday morning, 9:30 and 10:50. No Sunday school again next week, but Easter Sunday, we will celebrate a risen Lord. That's Holy Week. And that's our time of year. You understand that, don't you? From Christmas to Easter, so you can have the rest of the year off. No, that's not true. But what a wonderful thought that we get to celebrate the risen Lord next Sunday morning. So come and join us, we trust. And tonight, there is no evening service. Normally we have evening service, but not tonight. We have home fellowship groups. There's a couple sign-up sheets. You still can sign up and go to a home group if you'd like to tonight. So at the Welcome Center out in the lobby, if you'd like to just kind of jot your name down and find out the directions to the home groups, if you'd like to go to that. I think there's four locations this evening. Ushers, would you come, please? We'd love to receive our tithe and our offerings this morning. These might be the best-looking ushers we've ever had before. Let's take a moment, shall we? Our precious Heavenly Father, we love you today and count it a great privilege to worship. From the youngest to the oldest, we are your children. And we celebrate you today, Father. We thank you that you partner with us, Jesus, in kingdom building. And so, Lord, today we would ask that you would bless this tithe and these offerings, all to the impact of the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.
Majesty, worship is majesty. Jesus, be all glory, honor, and praise.
Yeah.
Any that would like to come this morning to kneel at the altar. I know it's kind of crowded in here, but there's an altar here that you can come and bow before if you'd like to at this time. It's good to be able to lay our burdens down. In just a moment, Pastor Isaac will lead us in prayer. I would like to make known a couple things. One is last Tuesday morning in the wee hours, our youth pastor, Tom Craig, lost his father. His dad, Tom Sr., passed away, and the services are back in Indiana this week, so please remember Tom and Jana and the family in this time of loss. Celebrate the good news. Jace Rushing is making his appearance today. I'm kind of surprised he's not up there playing with his dad at the bass. It's good to have little Jace with us. He was born about almost 2 weeks ago. Yeah, we're so glad to have him this morning. Can we take a moment together and just silence our hearts as Pastor Isaac comes and leads us?
God, we proclaim that you are great, that you are our King, Jesus. Cry out, Hosanna, God, save us, because you are the God who can save us. You are the God who takes the messed up things in our lives and in the lives of the people around us that we care about. You give us hope. You can help us to make things new again. Because of you, things can be the way you created it to be. And so we cry out, God, save us. Jesus, you are our Savior. You are our King. You are our friend. So we pray, would you continue to show us? At times we confess, if we're honest with ourselves, that we don't feel like you can save us. We don't feel like you can do anything. So we pray that you would help our unbelief. Give us courage. Help us to continue to press on and to move forward in your ways, knowing that you have called us to be people who are about the good, who are about putting broken things back together, who are about working in messed up, tough situations. And that as we do that, we are a part of your kingdom. Kingdom where things are made new, where lions live with lambs. And so as we proclaim that you are our King this morning, Jesus, we say, help us. Would you help us to remember that you are in control? Would you help us to continue to give you control of our lives and to surrender those things in our lives that are hard for us to give up? Help us to fully give ourselves to you. Lord, as we are worshiping with you this morning, we're remembering our dear brother, Tom Sr. Thank you for the gift that he was to our community. And we pray for his family, for his mom and his two sons, Pastor Tom and Tim, for his grandkids. We pray that you would give them peace. In a time when there doesn't seem to be peace, would you give them peace? Would you help the family this week as they grieve and as they celebrate? Would you help them to remember your presence with them? Would you help us, your hands and your feet, to care for our dear brother and family, as we remember his life and the way that he gave himself to you, we also see the other side and we celebrate our new family member in Jace. So thank you, God, for a safe arrival. Thank you for the blessing that he is already to his family and everyone who sees him and holds him. Would you continue to help him grow? Would you help us, your hands and your feet, his extended family, to be about the work of loving him and showing him what it looks like to be followers of Jesus? And now we turn our attention to your word. As Pastor Dave shares from his heart what you have laid on his mind and his heart, would you bless him? Would you clearly speak to us? We pray you would find us with open ears, open minds. Help us to be leaning in, listening to hear what you are going to teach us today. We give this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I love the energy that Taryn brings to the welcome. Never quite sure what she's going to say, but I love the energy. Can I tell you what I'm excited about? It is 10:38, and I have got a chance to preach till noon. Did I hear a disdain there? If I'm holding you till noon, you have the privilege to stand up and walk right out that door. It is good to be able to worship Jesus together and to celebrate what the traditional Palm Sunday was all about. The message today is entitled, The Day Before the Crowded Streets. And we'll look at the first 11 verses of chapter 12 in just a moment. But right now, I would like to look at John chapter 12, verses 12 through 19, to set the stage for the message this morning. John chapter 12, verses 12 through 19. The next day, let's start with 12. Push it forward one. There we go. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. If only they would have meant it. Jesus found a young donkey and said on it, as is written, Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. Colt is a cross between foal and colt. Just so you know. At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that these things had been done to him. Now the crowd that was with him, when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead, continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had performed this sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him. And don't you wish that were true? That the Jews would have recognized that he was indeed the King of Israel, and that the whole world would have gone after Jesus on that first Palm Sunday 2,000 years ago when they celebrated a king. This is what we think of when we think about Palm Sunday. Streets of Jerusalem packed because of the Passover, a buzz about Jesus going on. Most recently, he had raised Lazarus from the dead, and the word was spreading, and everybody wanted to see this miracle worker. A vast majority on that day were ready to coronate Jesus as Messiah, and they shouted in jubilation, Hosanna, which means save us now. Establish your throne now, King of Israel. Even the way Jesus entered into Jerusalem that day was spoken about by Zechariah the prophet some 500 years before it happened when he said, See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. The reason the crowd praised Jesus is very simple. Power. That's it. You see, Jesus possessed a power that could set them free. Jesus possessed a power that could heal people from illness. Jesus possessed an authority and a power that opened up the understanding of what the kingdom of God was really like. Jesus represents power. If Jesus can do all of these things reported about him over these last 3 years, then he has the power to save us today. And they were absolutely right. When they cried out, "Hosanna, save us now," Jesus had the power to save them. Just not the same way the crowd expected it or wanted it. Because it was not as they expected, many of the same ones who cried out, "Hosanna, King of Israel," would change their cry 5 days later and cry out, "Crucify him." Interesting. As long as the power flows and miracles spring forth, the praises flow. When that doesn't happen, questions arise. Is he or isn't he the Messiah? Now, I think that scripture that we looked at gives us an insight into the Pharisees. Even the Pharisees misjudged the crowd's allegiance to Jesus. They were kind of taken off guard that it was so electric in the city that day. And by the way, there may have been 1.5 million Jews gathered in Jerusalem for Passover, possibly. And the electricity in the air as Jesus enters into Jerusalem. They said, "Look how the whole world has gone after him." We know that this was not the case then or today. What changes in the mind of a person who has been convinced that Jesus is Lord to a person that turns against Jesus? Let me say that question again. What changes in the mind of a person who has been convinced that Jesus is indeed Lord to a person that later turns against Jesus? Could it be that Jesus didn't respond the way you wanted to when you faced a crisis? I wonder how many people have been disillusioned by something that didn't happen when they cried out to God. Possibly, you were persuaded to think differently by people or organizations that you respected. And incrementally, your opinion and thought of Jesus just began to change somewhat by the association. Or maybe you didn't nurture your soul's praise of who Jesus is and what he has already done for us. Can I say this to you this morning? Jesus is worthy of our praise. He has done enough in our lives already that if not one more thing happened in our lives, we have reason enough to live for Jesus the rest of our lives. We like it when he works in our favor. We like it when he hears our cry and he steps in and saves the day. But sometimes it's just knowing that Jesus is with me even when I don't have an answer to the problem or things don't quite turn out as I had hoped. I say to you this morning, the reasons why we change are many, but the results are the same. The spiritual edge of our walk with Jesus is dulled. Religious activities sometimes replace relational intimacy. And worst case scenario, we lose the greatest gift that was ever given to us, which is everlasting life. As much as I love the presence of God, every time we gather to praise his name, as much as I love the significance of Palm Sunday, the triumphal entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem on his way to Calvary's cross to redeem us, and I love the symbolism of our march today with people heading around the sanctuary waving palm branches or palm something, I love the symbolism of what that refers to, our praise and celebration, proclaiming to Jesus, we love him. These expressions of our worship for Jesus are precious and meaningful and hopeful, heartfelt for everyone in this sanctuary today. However, when I think of worship, I think about the day before the crowded streets. When I think about worship, I think about us bowing in adoration to Jesus when no one else is gathered. We can all celebrate and wave the palm branches today in honor of a king who comes every time we gather in this place. When two or three of us gather together in this house, in the name of Jesus, he is present. Hallelujah, he is here. And he desires to see us praise. He desires for our hearts to be open. He desires for us to fellowship in intimacy together as a body. Absolutely. But as much as significance as that plays in our lives, I really think that worship happens on the day before the call to worship. The day before the streets of Jerusalem were crowded. When it's just you and Jesus, are you and your family and Jesus, what does it look like then? So let's back it up, shall we? And look at those first 11 verses of chapter 19 this morning. The first 11 verses. I think I said chapter 19. Chapter 12. Verse 1. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Jesus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here, a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus sat among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume, and she poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As a keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well. If we could just get rid of that witness. Might have to take out Mary and Martha too. Not sure. For on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jerusalem and believing in him. Let's look at this episode where Jesus is at the home of longtime friends on the day before the streets. Notice the family, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, a brother and two sisters. We know the story of Jesus calling Lazarus from the tomb. At the request of Mary and Martha, Jesus makes his way to Bethany. And when he gets there, Lazarus is dead for 4 days. And Mary and Martha are mourning along with family and friends. And Jesus says to Lazarus, Lazarus, come forth. And he bursts out of the grave alive. Kind of a preview of what was about to take place just in about 7 days from, or maybe a couple weeks or a month from that time when Jesus rose Lazarus from the dead. How interesting. We see this family that Jesus loved. They loved Jesus deeply. We see this family. Mary worshiped with the alabaster jar or the pure nard, the perfume. Martha served. What a snapshot of Mary and Martha, huh? Martha is still serving and still doing everything and busy, 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 busy. And Mary's just going, oh, Jesus. And she's just sitting at Jesus' feet. This is so typical. Read the stories. You'll see that this is very true to Mary and Martha. But also we see Lazarus sitting at the table. He who had been dead, who is now alive, just visiting with the folk. How interesting. We see three different dynamics serving Jesus. When I think about Martha serving Jesus, I don't give Martha a bad rap at all. Or I don't give Mary a bad rap at all. Because both of those are significant elements. Serving and sitting are both so important. But when I think about serving Jesus, serving Him by the way we live, our lives in service one for another, I think of Martha taking care of the needs of the people who had gathered. I don't know if you're aware of this, but to make today happen, quite a few things had to happen in advance. This didn't just happen just because. This took a lot of people working behind the scenes. And by the way, while we sit in here and worship in the presence of the Lord, there are some who are in the nursery not having the same experience. Just saying. As they serve, as they care for our children. Service. Remembering Jesus' own admonition to us concerning our response to those around us. In Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 40, I want to read for you just what Jesus talked about when he talked about caring for the people of our world. He says this to his disciples. He says, our judgment will be partially based upon the way we serve one another. Listen to what Jesus said to his disciples. He said, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on the glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came and visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you as a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? And the king will reply, truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. And then he turns to the ones on his left and he says, basically, when I was all of these things, you did not attend to me. Service is what Jesus has empowered us to do. And when we look around and our eyes are open and we begin to recognize the concerns and the needs of people in our lives, it should then just begin to become a part of our DNA that when we see the needs of someone around us, that we step up and recognize that service to them is service to Jesus. They go together. And worship is embodied in service. In thinking about others before you think necessarily of yourself. Service. Martha worked at the house to make sure that the people would be cared for when they came in. And then we think about worship. Worship is so much more than just singing songs of praise and waving palm branches and saying Hosanna to the King. And it goes beyond actions of an ordinary moment. Worship reflects absolute allegiance to the King. And no sacrifice for that is too much or inappropriate. I mean, just throw that right out. That jar of expensive perfume that Mary broke and poured on Jesus' feet and then bowed before him and wiped those feet with her hair. Just throw it right out the window. That was not too extravagant. It doesn't matter if it was a year's wage. Jesus said, the poor you will always have with you, but you won't always have me. And by the way, she's just thinking about the needs that are in front of me, preparing me for a burial. Now, I don't really think that Mary was thinking about Jesus dying in just a few days. That probably was really not on the radar of any of the disciples or the followers of Jesus, that Jesus would die. But Jesus makes it very clear that she's doing something of worship and adoration no bars held. She's just letting go. Just letting go. I don't think I know what letting go means very well. Me personally. I go through periods of times where I think that I got a good grip on it, and I understand it pretty well, and things are not so difficult to surrender unto the Lord. And then there are other times that come in my life and I start thinking about, well, I sure would like to hold on to that. People ask me, this is a crazy example, but people ask me, hey, Pastor, what do you miss about Florida, where I pastored before here for 11 and a half years? What is it you miss about Florida? And my answer is so lame. Year-round softball. Isn't that is lame. Just saying. It's highly spiritual, too. Year-round softball. Well, you mean you used to play softball when it was 93, 94 degrees and 90% humidity? Yes, I did. In fact, if I was going to have a weekly weigh-in, I would always go after one of those doubleheaders. Because I felt much better about myself before I drank the fluid to replenish the 6 pounds that had wasted away. What do you miss about that? And then I tell you that just to say to you that there have been issues in my life with things like sports that have not been so easy to surrender. Do you mean, Lord, really, if you want me to speak for you for the rest of my life, do you really mean, Lord, that I can't play tournaments on Saturday and Sunday? That seems so narrow and restrictive. I'm sure the church won't mind if for those 6 months or so I'm gone. They're so narrow, that church, my pastor. And by the way, Lord, you do understand that this is something I've loved since I was a little guy. And it's a natural inclination. I just really find great significance in it. Yeah, I know, David, you're worshiping it. Really? Is it really coming across as worship? Now you fill in the blank for your own lives as to what it is that is difficult to surrender unto him. It is not until we make that absolute abandonment, that what some would consider to be excessive. You're going to give everything. In a couple weeks, I'm going to talk about the little lady that gave 2 coins to Jesus. The only coins to her name, she gave them both to Jesus. We're going to talk about that in a couple weeks. You'll have to come back on April 28th. We'll talk about that sacrifice of everything unto the Lord. There is nothing, I say it again to you, there is nothing that is too important or too great of a surrender to be placed in a column of excessive when it comes to Jesus. By the way, did not Jesus give his very life that we might be saved? Could we not in turn give our very life so that we might live for him? Sacrifice, worship. And the last element this morning is Lazarus sitting. The man who Jesus had just raised from the dead a few days earlier is sitting at the table with his friends and his Savior. If we could ask Jesus, how's it going? How's it going, Lazarus? He'd say, I'm just living the dream. I was dead, now I'm alive because of this man. Recently, I went to a John Crist concert on Friday night, and he talked a little bit about Lazarus, only he came at it from an interesting point of view, which I thought was how funny that is. But here Lazarus is in heaven already, and Jesus calls him back, and he goes, hey, wait a minute! You kidding me? Want to leave this place? But we'll leave John in his own world, okay? John Crist, if you want to Google him, he's a riot. But Lazarus was dead and was raised by the power of Jesus. And now he's sitting at the table with the one who called him out of the grave. I'm alive because of this man sitting here with me. I tell you this so that you won't miss the most important thing to remember. We get to live our lives sitting with Jesus too. Please don't forget that. That he doesn't just occupy the sanctuary when we come together in his name, but he's going to be sitting with you as you're driving your car. He's going to be sitting with you when you sit at your desk at work. He's going to be sitting with you in your lounge chair at home watching the Royals. I found out Jesus is a great Royals fan. Sorry, Daryl. He loves the Yankees too, but I don't know why. Jesus sits with us wherever we go. Could we grasp a hold of that for just a moment this morning and think about there is no place that we could possibly go from this sanctuary today where Jesus is not going to be with us. The question is, do we invite him in with us? He's going to recline with you wherever you go. Of course we worship Jesus as our Lord and King and sacrifice our everything to him, but we get to live with him every day. In closing, think about this. It doesn't really matter if you are experiencing some of your best days ever in life or if you're going through extreme trials and sorrow today. The Lord loves you. He is acquainted with your joy, and he is acquainted with your grief. And as surely as Jesus rode into Jerusalem 2,000 years ago under the canopy of praise and adoration, as the hosannas rang out and the palm branches were waved in jubilation, the cry was and is the same for us today. Jesus, save us. The message has not changed. It still is. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Oh, Jesus, save me. And he can. He has that power to save us. So may our worship tomorrow, when we are all by ourselves, be as centered upon him as his will is for us today. Lord, you can save me. I have found that salvation is sometimes really dramatic, and other times it just subtly sinks into our lives. I have found that salvation is from external factors, and sometimes it's from internal factors. whatever it is, Jesus has the power to save. Heavenly Father, stand with me, please. Heavenly Father, would you please just remind us of how deeply you love us and remind us, Lord Jesus, that there is nowhere we could possibly go where you are not present. We love you, Father, and thank you for this assembly of your children today, young and old. We thank you, Father, that you could walk with us as we leave this place and bless us with your presence as we recline with you wherever we are, as we serve you by serving our fellow brother and sister, and as we worship you with a radical surrender of ourselves to you. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you remain standing as Pastor Isaac pronounces benediction?
May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you and remind you that he, your King Jesus, is with you. Go in peace.